Andre Young, known as Dr. Dre, and his seminal rap group, N.W.A.
Straight out of Compton, it's a crazy brother named Ice Cube. From the stupid dope gang with an attitude. When I'm caught off, I got a sawed off. Kick knowledge and bodies all hauled off.
It was this new sound, soon to be dubbed gangster rap, that Suge Knight would seize on and turn into the age's most controversial and commercially successful style of music.
Death Row.
So some of y'all black folks don't appreciate what we talking about, but this is the only way we got to make money. And if you don't let me make my money on the streets, I guarantee you I will make my money on the streets. And then I'm gonna have to bring guns into it. Now y'all buy my record and support a real nigga, cause I'm staying real.
Eazy-E, he convinced Dre to join up with him and leave Ruthless.
They took advantage of me not knowing the record business back in the day. But you know, I know what's up with those numbers now. Can't be with.
Charging he was forced to release Dre from his deal.
Under threat of his life and telling him that they would kill his mother and that they were holding me hostage, under those kinds of duress, got him to sign releases for Dr. Dre.
Suge, nearly twice the size of Eazy-E, dismissed the accusations, as did the court.
Do I need a bat, you know, to force him to do a few things? If he walked between my legs, excuse my friends, people probably would think he was my penis. So, you know,
don't mad. I'm finna go make, Bob, I'm finna make you real mad right now. You with Dolores Tucker. I'm finna make a hit for y'all right now called We Love Snoop, F all y'all.
This is a bit, yeah. Every record that I put out from day one, it sold a million records. It don't matter about the equipment. It depends on the nigga that's working. And I am that nigga. And I can make a motherfucking hit.
Dr. Dre, listen, I always act. I feel is that, you know, being young and being in America, having without acting is easy. Because you always want, I want to act like everybody else. Anything to be up out of the ghetto.
I live a thug life, baby, I'm hopeless. Choking on Fendo, trying to keep my focus. Don't let the punk cowards worry me. Keep the fame, I'm true to the game till they bury me.
At 24, Tupac Shakur was a platinum-selling artist, the movie star, and an inmate at the Dannemora Jail in upstate New York. It took Suge Knight $1.4 million and a two-page contract to make Tupac a free man. And a Death Row recording artist.
This is what Death Row was waiting for, this is what I've been waiting for. So now with the combination, it's like we superpowers now.
Say what you say, but give me that bomb beat from Dre. Let me serenade the streets of LA. From Oakland to Sacktown, the Bay Area and back down. Cali is where they put they Mac down. Give me love.
If you come to Death Row, you will see your art brought to a bigger plateau and you will be paid one of these days.
I hope my words can paint a perfect picture and let you know how much a brother miss you. Pour out some liquor.
Tupac had first worked with Death Row in 94 on the label's third release, the soundtrack to Above the Rim, a film he also starred in. His attraction to the gangsterism at Death Row was already apparent.
Everybody out here got cases and a real brain and real thug lives to match these thug records. Now you show me that on the other side and we could talk some.
Tupac brought so much to Death Row. A, he was already a movie star. He already had a persona that had a really hard edge to it.
If you open your mouth against me, I will get you. No matter how much time they give me, believe me, I will be free and you will see me. So watch your mouth.
He was a very, very fine lyricist. And he was a star. He just had that star thing.
Every time I speak, I want to shiver. You know, I don't want them to be like, they know what I'm going to say because it's polite. They know what I'm going to say. And even if I get in trouble, you know what I'm saying? That ain't that what we're supposed to do.
What Death Row did is it took that, the harder side of Tupac and really burnished it.
Tupac was not your typical rapper. Raised by his mother to be politically and artistically aware, Tupac saw his life transform when his mother grew addicted to crack. They moved to Oakland, and Tupac found himself drawn to the streets and its fierce life. The different strands of his contradictory existence found expression in his lyrics, such as his tender tribute, Dear Mama.
You always was committed, a poor single mother on welfare. Tell me how you did it, there's no way I can pay you back. But the plan is to show you that I understand.
Tupac's wild side was also the stuff of legend. He'd been in and out of jails and courtrooms since he became a rapper and survived being shot 5 times in New York before being convicted of sexual assault. Sent to a maximum security prison.
When I already got shot in New York, I was on the plane in New York. And it tore me apart. I was crying, I thought he was dead. And when I found out he was all right, and he had went to jail, I had told Suge, I said, Suge, We need to get Pac on death row. He need to be here with us. Went and got him. Remember David Kendall went and got him out of there, untangled him, put him in the studio as soon as he got out.
Suge and death row attorney David Kenner untangled Tupac's jail term with $1.4 million in bail money. Tupac signed a two-page contract with death row outside the jail and within 15 days had wrapped All Eyes on Me, a double album that sold 7 million copies. Death row now had two of rap's biggest superstars.
Snoop is the Grizzly Adams of dogs, I'm telling y'all, straight up right there. The boy really know the dog. I mean, they seen the video where he changed into a dog, and they think Snoop is a dog. They always want to change back. They all be just kicking outside the dog. I was waiting for the dog to change. Like, woo, woo, we gonna change, hold on.
He ain't going nowhere.
Let me tell you about life and about the way it is. You see, we live by the gun, so we die by the gun.
Tell me not to roll with my Glock, so now I gotta throw away, floating in my black bin, trying to do a show a day. They wonder how I live with five shots. Brothers, it's hard to kill on my block.
We got everything it takes to run this industry. We the new Motown.
He the type can be like a brother, a friend, because he real. You know, he don't get caught up in the booth, into the Hollywood. He just want to make sure he do a great job for you. And he gonna represent you to the fullest, as long as you represented him to the fullest.
Suge doted on him.
They were inseparable. Tupac was with him all the time.
I think Tupac did make some adjustment in his life when he came to death row. I think he brought a great deal to death row, but he also took on that death row image, so to speak.
Next year, Death Row gonna start printing our own money. Cause we making so much, we need to start printing our own money. It's gonna be me and Suge on the $100 bill like this. Me, Suge, and Dot Move. It's gonna be in the $100 bill.
He was going all out to be this Death Row person, you know what I mean? To live up to these myths. It's just this hardcore, I don't give up, you know, kind of cat. And having interviewed Tupac Shakur many times before he went to Death Row Records, I knew that that was not him.
He went along with whatever Death Row wanted to go along with at that time, at first. Also, I think Tupac had plans for Tupac because he's, you know, he was that kind of individual.
One thing that Tupac did was jump in the middle of a beef between Suge and Bad Boy Entertainment CEO Sean Puffy Combs. Suge made the beef public when he dissed Puffy at the Source Magazine Music Awards in 95.
Any artist out there want to be an artist and want to stay a star and don't want to have to worry about the executive producer trying to be all in the videos, all on the record, dancing, come to Death Row.
He hated on Bad Boy Entertainment. Hated.
Hated.
He hated on, I mean, basically any beef that was created, it was him hating. Suge felt you had to ride. That's how you get record sales. That's how we look like we bad.
Tupac, once close to Bad Boy rapper Notorious B.I.G., began to accuse Biggie of responsibility for his being shot in 95. He also boasted that he'd had sex with Biggie's wife, Faith Evans.
Hey, Fat Boy. First off, touch your chick in the click you claim. Westside, when we rock, I'm equipped with game. You claim to be a player, but I bust your wife. We bust on Bad Boys, brothers touch for life.
Tupac almost was reborn. You know, he really was into hanging with Suge and all that. I think that the chemistry of those guys created some interesting music for Tupac, but I think a lot of dissension happened in the company. The things that started to change at Death Row changed faster when Tupac arrived.
The biggest change was Dr. Dre deciding to leave Death Row. Dre, who'd been in and out of trouble with the law during his involvement with the label, had served time in prison for a parole violation and was growing tired of the gangster mentality Death Row had so masterfully projected.
You put out negative energy, it's going to come back to you, period. Live by the gun, die by the gun.
4 years earlier, by the efforts of Suge Knight, Dre left Death. Tupac Shakur arrived with the rest of his posse at the MTV Video Music Awards in New York. Backstage, Tupac said he was ready to battle Death Row's East Coast nemesis, the people from Bad Boy Records.
They see us and they want drama, we gonna definitely bring it like only Death Row could bring it.
Thanks to Suge, Tupac had been out of jail for almost a year, and his first Death Row release, All Eyes on Me, had been a massive hit. Some, though, say Tupac wasn't happy with his life at the label.
Tupac was trying to get off of Death Row. That's why he did those albums so fast, because he had, a 3-album deal. And he was trying to move on.
Tupac loved Death Row. Tupac loved me, I loved him. You'd ask Tupac that question, that was he planning on leaving Death Row, he definitely would cuss you out.
Pac wanted to leave Death Row bad. hated it. But he knew this was the hand that was feeding me. He got me out of trouble. I'm still going through this. I'm still going through that. How can I do it?
Those who claim Tupac wanted out of Death Row say the rapper felt he wasn't seeing his fair share of
money. Everybody's beef with Death Row at the time was money.
That Machiavelli album, 7 Day Theory, that was more or less a sacrifice album. I need to make Suge more money. I don't even know how much I owe Suge.
Exactly.
He say I do. I need to make more money, then I'm gonna start this Machiavelli label.
Tupac's alleged complaints about the money he received was part of a long music biz tradition. While there's no question that many Death Row artists live very well, whether they own the toys that they played with is another story.
Whatever transpired with Death Row in terms of artists feeling they were exploited over advances or money loaned to them, that could have been happening anywhere. And it does every day.
Then on September 7th, 1996, came the encounter that would destroy Death Row as the music world knew it. As Suge, Tupac, and their posse were leaving the MGM Grand in Las Vegas, someone in their group spotted an alleged Southside Crip named Orlando Anderson, who months earlier had been blamed for the theft of a Death Row medallion. There was a confrontation, then a beatdown. Hours later, as Tupac rode in the passenger seat of Suge's car, another car pulled alongside theirs and opened fire. 6 days later, Tupac was dead of his wounds. In December of that year, that MGM Grand surveillance tape was used to send Suge Knight to prison, with his kicking of Orlando Anderson judged a violation of Suge's parole on a previous charge. He was given 9 years.
He has a history of violence, and I am concerned for those people that are out in the community that are potential victims.
Even as Tupac's posthumously released album Machiavelli dominated the charts, Death Row
bring it to the foe. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the dope, ready to make an entrance, so back on up.
Before I have to pull the strap off the cut,
give me the microphone first so I can bust like a bubble. Compton and Long Beach together, now you know you in trouble, cause ain't nothing but a G-thang, baby. Two low-def G, so we crazy. Death Row is the label that pays me. Unfadable, so please don't try to fake this. But back to the lecture at hand. Perfection is perfected, so I'm a lad, I'm understanding. From a young G's perspective, and before me, they got a trick, I have to find a contraceptive. You never know, she could be earning her man, and learning her man, and at the same time, burning her man. Now if she burning, I'ma chill for a minute, cause ain't no loving good enough to get burned while I'm offended.